Thank you, Edmund Pastor.
This is interesting what you said. I just want to make a simple comment. The first draft of the RTI bill was presented in December 2004 in the Parliament. December 2004. And in that, very clearly it was mentioned that the time for disposal by the Commission and the first appellate authority is identical. I can send that to anybody. By some state of hand, when the final bill was presented in May, there was no explanation, nothing. There was a parliamentary committee that had gone into this. But this was, by a state of hand, just removed. And I think the point is very well taken. Time-bound decisions by commissions are very important. Maharashtra, I concede, has had a problem of non-appointment of commissioners. But this is not true over the nation. Lots of places there are enough commissioners, but clearances are not really happening. So I think we need to address this, and civil society perhaps needs to focus on this, which it is not generally focusing on. Sir, would you like to share?
We must understand about the RTI that it is probably the fifth state of the democracy. Right to information is something more than what media is, which is the fourth state. And transparency of information available to the government becomes the fifth state. It has to be there because it brings in justice for the all population, as you very rightly said, that this is the right of the people. And they must get it. But now related to that, how it has happened, I must tell you, when the first time in 2005 the Act came, I was additional general manager of Western Railway. In fact, sir, I came to one of your workshops at the Government Law College, where you did it for the students of St. Xavier's College and Jain College. I came and sat there among them just to understand what you were telling. Because we all never understood what was RTI and how we should be. I was the appellate authority for the whole Western Railway. And I learnt a lot that they quietly sit in one corner and gave lectures. I think there were two other people. I remember probably you were also there in Government Law College. Back in 2005. But what is more important in this is, it should not be taken as a grievance letter. This is my view. There may be a mistake committed by somebody. The right is of information, not of grievance letter. He must get the information. Something has been done like this. This is the record of the government. Now whether it is right or wrong, that should not be committed. That is my view. Because there is always subjectivity. High Court may pass an order and Supreme Court may overrule it. Supreme Court may pass an order and Constitution Bench may overrule it. This is bound to happen. A bureaucrat may think X to be right. Another bureaucrat, maybe junior or senior, may not agree with him. What has happened on Western, I found that even when I was giving all the information available, if the grievance was not redressed, an appeal was made. You are all very intelligent people, and Mr. Jain is here. Please understand that this is not a forum for grievance letters. They are right to get the information. If somebody has, it is CR, has not been made fit for the general manager or the secretary to Government of India, he must get the factual position. This is what is written. If you do not agree with it, go to CAT. But then, today it is more available. CAT decided that all CRs, APRs should be made available. Everybody has a copy, but in 2005 it was not there. But now you cannot decide that this APR has been wrongly written, so this should be changed. No, that is not the job of the information. And that is where a lot of problems are coming. I have encountered 2-3 very strong reactions to appeal decided by me when a person who was expecting some payment from the government, from the government, and I believe he went to the Central Information Commission also. I got transferred and he did not get the leave there. But he came and fought. Yeah, I must get my payment. I said, but payment I can't arrange. I have given the fact. This is what is available. This is the noting. These are the papers. Now you go and talk to the people concerned. But if you want redress, these are the officers. That officer is not additional employer. I am here as an appellate officer. This is still not getting addressed. This is one thing. Because people are taking it as a grievance, which it is not, it should not be. Second is, I have a problem with the language. See, language is a very serious issue for the country. And I'll give my personal cases from that. We have, 30 lakh employees in railways, out of which about 11 lakh are group D, workers in the world. They don't know English. They're not very adept in Hindi either, if they are in South or in Gujarat or even Maharashtra. They're not very good at Hindi. They're given a charge sheet in English. Why your increment should not be withheld for so and so, and this is what you have done. What does he do? He doesn't understand what is happening there. I made it a rule on Western Railway that the charge sheet should be in two languages, English and vernacular. If you say I can accept it in Hindi, give it in Hindi, otherwise give it in Marathi or Gujarati. Because that man doesn't understand the language. He goes to a trade union leader who charges 500 rupees. So, increment to aapne ek rok hi diya. Ek increment to usko automatically aap rok diya. So, 500 rupees kharch karne pade. To understand what is the charge sheet. Here also we are saying that transaction will be either in English or Hindi. I think this is a shortcut. I'm a Hindi speaking man. But I think in Kannada mein aur Malayalam mein jo employees hain, jo rural log hain, how will they understand? They do not understand English or Hindi. So they will go to a right activist. I don't know why there should be activist in right information, but that is the role of the activist. They go there, they must be getting charged, I am about 95% sure of that. And I don't know whether the correct information is still being given to them after translation. But if you give it in the vernacular language, I am very sure that he will understand Gujarati, he will understand Malayalam, he will understand Tamil. They all, people, education is now about more than 80% in the country. I think Mr. Jain will also agree with me on that. Language is a very serious issue for this country. We are together. I know in 60s how bad it had become when we were in college and university. And we almost thought that the country was getting divided. Fortunately, our leaders at that time were sagacious enough to solve that problem. And I feel that though it is not being raised, that it is very important. These two things I'd like to mention, that that is how it should be seen and addressed in the draft rules. And even if, since they are draft rules, I will request your word is very seriously taken by the government. I think if you have a view on it, if you agree with me, please bring in that change.
Thank you very much, sir. To address the issue of language that you brought in, at the Central Commission, you get things from all across the nation. You get a RTI application in Tamil, all in Telugu, and so on. Very few, I must concede. And the attempt was to see if some staff knew that language.
Okay.
Then we'd ask him to. But once or twice, I don't recall which the language was. There was nobody one who could understand. So we had just no option. And I used to look at this practically and say that how should the central government function? I've tried to think about it. Should we each office have translators for every language of this nation? I mean, if we have to really address it in that fashion, we should. But I was just wondering how practical or feasible that would be, sir.
We have made to. So today it is available on computers.
Those are poor translations, sir. I mean,
I think they have improved a lot. If you don't agree with it, point is that person doesn't know English or Hindi, should he be denied justice?
I'm in complete agreement with you.
But I think we can take help of computers, web, or software. There are software available now. We had to
maybe, I think that's a good idea.
And if it is not there, then let the commission spend some money or the government of India spend some money. I feel a person, if he doesn't know Hindi or English, should not be denied justice in this country. And if you have to spend 50 crore for it, please spend.
Well, I hope somebody listens to this.
They may listen to you.
The other thing you said, sir, is about RTI activists charging by and large. My observation has been, and this is unique in this nation, most RTI users, activists, do things for free. In fact, a majority of them spend money out of their own pockets.
Okay.
If somebody doesn't have a 10 rupee port fee stamp, he says, yeah, we'll take it out, tomorrow kaam kar do. So that is there. Anyway, thank you, sir. Now, would I think, Priyanka, you wanted to...
I don't have anything to say about
this. No, at the end. So then I'll ask, I was told you would like to be at the end.
No, I mean, I just would like, I could just talk about all this.
No, but we've said ladies would like to have the last word.
Yeah. Thank you, Sharishma.
Sandeep. No, no, that's what I was saying.
Thank you, Sharishma. I immediately come to rule 3, which prescribes a limit, it provides a prescribed limit of 500 words. Although at the same breath, it says that on this ground, the application will not be rejected. But then there is a risk of the PIO withholding the application, of the applicant saying that you reduce the number of words. So there is a chance of sabotaging the furnishing of information. And it didn't serve any purpose. Although there are kind of informal applications which does exceed this limit. But at the, if the rule can be amended to the extent saying that it also doesn't entitle the PIO to withhold the information also, application. It provides what I'm saying. When it says that it doesn't engage or follows the rejection of the application, it should also say that the PIO should not withhold the application on this ground. This is my one of the suggestions. Secondly, in Rule 5, it says it prescribes for DPL category of people a certificate provided by the government. So I believe that there are existing DPL cards, Russian card, there must be the documents. On that premise, it should be given. There shouldn't be any separate certificate should be provided by the government for this. I mean, this should go, otherwise, again, there could be a frustration of rights.
Which
Rule 5 should
be? Rule 5, sir.
My only thing is, what they mean by certificate is, and that's like,
there should not be any ambiguity insofar as interpretation is concerned.
I see that.
Existing documents should permit.
Absolutely.
Then we come to Rule 8.2. Yes. See, 8.2 rules describes a very legalistic thing of making appeal. I mean, this is very dangerous. It actually goes against the very spirit of the RTI Act, where if a parent has to file in the like of proceedings which are filed in the court of law, rejoinders, spacing, I mean, typewritten, this should go, it's very dangerous. Then Rule 9. This return of appeals, although it does provide a very limited, on two grounds it will not be returned. What it says, appeal may be returned if it is not accompanied by the documents as specified in Rule 8 for removing the deficiencies and finding the appeal complete in all respects. It's always a very matter of subjectivity. It's not complete, it's complete. It's very easy to make out any deficiency in any appeal. We have seen in courts. It's very easy. And therefore, on no ground, in fact, on material, if there is some material deficiency, shortcoming, then it's fine. Otherwise, the appeal should not be returned. At least on minor technicalities. Although two grounds are there on which the appeal should not be returned, it's stated. Still, appeal should not be returned unless there is some serious shortcomings. The law orders are not attached, the order which is under challenge. Then we come to Rule 11.1. This is also very, in my view, dangerous. It says, it talks about some interested person. It is a class of category which I did not find in the RTI Act. So, it may become a tool clustering a very sensitive information which could be provided under the RTI. What it says, the commission while deciding an appeal may receive oral or written evidence from concerned person or interested person. We don't know what constitutes, because interested person is not defined anywhere. We know third parties, the appellant, the PIO, FAA. So I don't know who are these interested persons. Anybody may intervene. He talks about interveners. Who are these interveners? No interveners should be permitted in this. Interveners is also there. I showed where it talks about some interveners.
You actually 11-1.
No, intervenors.
Intervenors, you know, the expression intervene is also used.
Interveners.
Interested person should be taken like that when you say the specific word.
Shall I, it is in definition. Who I. So this is also very dangerous. It talks about interveners. So what is interveners?
I completely agree. I miss this, but this is a serious problem.
Because it will frustrate, make frustrating.
No, I completely concede that
who J.
Then we come to rule 13.4. It talks about limitation of 90 days for filing complaint. Actually, this particular law, any law which takes away the rights of any person, should come in the main body of law. By a delegated legislation, it is ordinarily not permitted. So it should come in the main, and by way of rules, a right of a person cannot be taken away. Although it is not entirely taken away, because it does say it provides a condonation, but then it's very procedural. From when we look at the point of, as Sharish Bhai has rightly said, this the profile of a person who uses the RTI is the poorest of the poor person. So if we look at from his perspective, it's very difficult to file condonation, and again it's very discretionary to the authorities. So there should not be any limitation. It can't be even legally also. Because by delegated legislation, you can't take it. It should facilitate. These are the adverse points which I've seen. And the good points, as been said, it's online payment of fees also. That's very encouraging thing. And conversion of complaint into second level, that's very also encouraging. And then the shortcoming which sir has pointed out of review, it's very good. If it can be introduced by way of review, powers of review of commissions. They can recall their orders on the patent shortcomings, although there are judgments of Apex Court, which clearly says even if the review is not provided under the statute, the authorities, adjudicating authorities, does have the power of review, recalling their orders on patent shortcomings, be pointed out. But then, if it can come by way of legislation, delegated legislation, then it could be a good thing. Thank you.
Thank you, Sanjeev.
Double spacing, you are right, is a serious issue.
All these
complaints. You mentioned that delegated legislation cannot restrict a person's right. If you argue that, then you know the 500 word limit can be argued.
Yes.
I mean, however, and this I am admitting, when I was a commissioner, used to at times get, initially I said we just go by the law, and we used to get complaints for something 2 years back. And it was, I mean, the amount of resource the commissioner would have to spend to address that. So I had come up with something which I called an office order, so that my people who were working with me would work either as basically as per the law, but if I issued an office order, I would be responsible. In which I had said, after 180 days, return the complaint. This is more a practical thing, because if you have said, theoretically, a 5-year-old matter can be complained. And it should be done, I'm not disputing that, but in a country where we are today not delivering decisions within reasonable time, it's a matter of saying which has higher priority. Thank you.
Is that the Act has said very clearly whether it is 500 words, whether 150 words, in some of the states it is 150 words. The 500, if it is more than 500 words, there is no question of returning the applications are there, the section 5.3 states very clearly the assistance needs to be provided. If he finds that if it is fired, what is given, the PRO can call the applicant and prioritize his requirement of the information and he can do that. That is what assistance needs to be there, because Act says it is reasonable and assistance will provide.
I think, Bhaskar, we are living in a fairy tale. Let us accept that that's not the possibility at all. I'm hoping commissioners at least do that. To expect it at the PR level is a little too premature.
I mean, when you're seeking information, why should the application be more than 500?
Yeah, that's not.
Go, okay, yes, we'll take it off later.
Because it is going as grievance.
Sir, we'll take it off.
We'll take it off first.
Priyanka, yeah. Priyanka, obviously, she's used RTI and I'm very glad. Most media persons who, in the initial days, I used to go about canvassing, telling media persons, please use RTI, you can come up with earth-breaking stories. And they used to listen to me, but hardly anyone followed it. And one of them said, you know, Mr. Gandhi, our source is faster. RTI is a hot time lag jata hai. And yes, that is true. RTI does take time. But I would urge media persons also to consider that using RTI is strengthening democracy. There are problems. Once you face the problems, you will write about it. You will hopefully align with the normal citizen and hope to improve the entire structure of democracy. Apart from which, if you heard of Catherine Wu, she has built almost her entire career on RTI. And her fantastic book written on Bombay describes Andheri, a section of Andheri which I am completely oblivious of. So I would urge all media persons to write about it and write about persuading others to write about it. Okay, yes, Priyanka.
So there's now a greater reluctance on the part of government officials to give the kind of information they did earlier. Because there's been a change in government, and we've had that case in the central government where information was leaked from that petroleum ministry, and I think after that there's been much more wariness in parting with information. Now, the story, I'll just share with you my experience about the story that I was pursuing, which was the allotment of land to Patanjali. Now, obviously, this is an issue in which cooperation from government was zero, and my only option was getting information through RTI. And you know, thanks to Mr. Gandhi, you know, who looked at my RTI drafts, I was looking for something extremely specific, which was the waiver that was given by the government. It was a 75% discount on the land allotted to Patanjali, which was valued at 1 crore. The land was given at 25 lakhs. Actually, the announcement that the land would be allotted was, if the announcement was made in February, then the land was actually allotted in August. So, even before there was any call for tenders. So in this situation, I was asking, I knew that there was a subcommittee that looked at the pricing of the land. And very specifically, because Mr. Gandhi always says, be very specific. So, I said, I want the report of that subcommittee. Dated on this particular year. Now, I sent the application last May. There was like for a frantic call from somebody. First of all, I didn't even know which department, and that's a big stumbling block in RTI. You don't know which department. But finally, I sent it to the MADC. And I get a call from the PIO saying your draft is in the wrong format, which was completely untrue. And then she sent me the format which the central government uses for central government official whatever RTI format, which seemed very dated and old, but I said, okay, forget it, let me do it according to this format. So I lost a month there because I sent a fresh RTI application, which was maybe a mistake. I get no response at all. So then I file a first appeal, no response, then I file a second appeal, and I was wondering what's going on, you see. Finally, I wrote to the I sent an appeal there. Of course, because of the pendency of cases, another 3-4 months went by, and finally I got totally frustrated. So I went and met Mr. Gaikwad, which initially I was wondering whether it was a wrong thing to do, because you don't want to be seen as in pushing somebody, in that position to look at your application above others. But he had a, he said, no, we must, take this up, in, and he issued a notice to all the departments. And shockingly, within 2 weeks, I got all the information beyond what I had asked for. And, I was able to do a story right when the assembly session was on, talking about the fact that there was an objection or questions raised about that waiver, and which led to the transfer of that official. And in fact, the reaction to it was such that somebody took it up and filed a PIL in the High Court. So that's where it's at. And there was no way this information would have come out if it weren't for RTI, because there was nobody parting with this information. And increasingly, I find this is the case in this government, that there's a fear of giving information among the officials. And people may talk and tell you things, but particularly when it comes to issues like cabinet notes, which at one time we were able to access through various cooperative positions, particularly on matters of public interest, now they're just not given. If it comes to, so I find that, while we say the source will give you the information faster, currently the sources are saying use the RTI. I don't want to be considered as the one who gave you the information. So you go through RTI, and also what happens is if you use the RTI, I find the official gets targeted anyway because he's considered as the person who tipped you off about what is happening. So I think there's currently this larger picture in which we find ourselves, and I'm most grateful to him for suggesting along the way various things I should do. One of the things that, so for me the whole question was how much do you pursue this, and most journalists don't pursue it, and they would have left it at the first appeal, and I knew that, and it was this, there was just no letter at all. So I used to wonder, has it reached? I just had those things saying received. That's it, And the kind of excuses given later was that PIO was transferred. Now that's a very common excuse. PIO was transferred. Wo usne kiya, mujhe nahin pata. This is the typical excuse that we find, the other issue is we don't often know which department to apply to. And nobody guides you after that. They just say this is not our department, So for instance, if you're applying for something very generic, like, air travel of a minister. So you wonder whether you should ask for all ministers to GAD, or whether you should ask in each specific department. Things like that. So these are some of the questions that this particular case was with the Maharashtra Airport Development Corporation, and finally the kind of it wasn't even much. It was just like maybe 10 or 20.
Nagpur.
No, it was here. The land was in Nagpur. The department is in Kakarate, and it took 1 year for them to give me 15 pages. And that also after Mr. Gaikwad summoned the chief secretary and everybody concerned. So there have been cases where I know something has happened, and I know that something has been written on a particular note, and I ask for that information and the department says it doesn't exist. So what do you do with that? And then you go back to the official and you're told it exists. So.
Thank you, Priyanka. Just one or two things. The central government has no format, basically. Whoever said that was lying. No, I'm just telling you for future. Central government, there is no format at all. Maharashtra government has a format. And to your issue about not knowing the department, really speaking, the Act provides that you can fight with any department, any public authority, and it should be transferred. Now, sometimes people have argued that how do we know? And I have told people that the government can't know. How will a citizen know? I mean, it's a very pathetic admission. And I've had one RTI application, which has, I filed it with GAD. GAD sent it to CM's office sent it back to GAD. It was sent to Information Technology Department, and the final answer came from the Chief Minister's office. But this is wrong and bad. I think the government must organize itself. But the law clearly says you do not have to go running around to find the department. Okay, now I think I...
So before we list out the key areas of discussion that we need to take forward, a few observations from my side as well. I think what we haven't discussed is Rule 16.4, which is a positive provision again, which says that in on the off chance that the Commission does not specify a time period, the time period will be taken as 30 days, which is, I think, something we haven't appreciated in this panel, number one. And number two, as far as electronic payments was concerned, Mr. Jalan brought that up, that has been that provision is identical to the ones in the 2012 rules, word to word identical, and not much has been done in that department. It's not that departments earlier that were not accepting e-payments have now switched to e-payments. That's obviously not happened. So since we are talking about digital India and cashless economy, should we not make this in the rules a mandatory thing for them that within, say, a given time period of, say, 3 months or the next 6 months, they should set up provisions to compulsorily accept e-payments wherever it can be done.
If Bajiwala is expected to deal digitally, the government should.
Exactly. I'll just quickly lay out the key points of discussion that I thought were the common themes running everybody's feedback. Number one was better quality and fast disposal of appeals, which was one of the needs of something that the rules needed to be addressed. So in that we spoke about how there's no time limit for disposing appeals that the commission, there's no time limit that's been imposed on the commission as far as pending the appeal is concerned. Lack of review was one thing that Sir brought up, again something that can be added to make disposing appeals a more efficient matter. Video conferencing was one thing that Mr. Galgali also brought up. Second theme I thought was need for comprehensive rules. That is also something each one of you was able to point out something in that was lacking within these rules. So I think in this discussion maybe we can have a back and forth as to say what the activists feel should be included and what Mr. Jain thinks or Mr. Sai thinks from the bureaucracy perspective is possible to implement. So on that, say service of appeal by appealants was brought out by Mr. Bhaskar Prabhu. Sai sir talked about how more languages need to be added to be made compulsory within those rules. So I think this was one thing that we need to discuss. Number three was problematic provision, the rigidity of the rules. That was also another common theme that everybody seemed to want to speak about in great detail. So coordination of delay, the use of intervention or an intervener within the rules. What does that mean for the rules? Whether that should stay, go away. The limit of 500 words that we talked about. Rule 5, Rule 11 being vaguely worded. So I think these are things that we can talk about as to where the overall rule seems to be fine, but specific words or specific provisions within those rules sort of render it to be more confusing, and that can be done away with without prejudicing the rules as well, that particular provision or the rules as whole. Number 4 is something that you all talked about, was digitalization should reduce procedures and burdens on applications. Now this is, seems to be a common theme also around the table. So maybe some ideas, and we can do some back and forth on what digital steps are we talking about. Some, a few examples of where digitization was used in other departments, which can be used here, or what are the ways, what do people have in mind when you talk about digitization. And obviously section 12 is something that there seems to be consensus around the table as such, that section 12 is a problematic provision that on some level probably needs to go away. Now, in this context, I'd just like to introduce something that Mr. Gandhi told me, that in 2011, they had passed a resolution within the Central Information Commission, which said that if an applicant was gravely injured or was killed during the pendency of the RTI application, whatever information he was seeking will be put up on the website Suomoto. So I think that's one of the models that we can follow as far as that is concerned. So maybe some more discussion about, now we all agree that Rule 12 is wrong or needs to be replaced. So maybe some discussion on what are the alternatives to Rule 12. What should happen on the death of a person if a person is threatened or gravely injured. So I think that is one area of discussion. So I just leave it to Sir to begin with these themes and
had one point which Mr. Jain actually brought out in the part where Adweep said that there is a need for comprehensive rules. I thought Mr. Jain put forth a very important point where he said that how we can, you know, there is a lot of talk about rights of services, Public Records Act, and proactive disclosure that has come up, and how it can be integrated through procedure. I thought this is very important because we've been talking in the media a lot, you know, that media is talking a lot about right of services and how this can be integrated. And Mr. Jain can really elaborate a little on that because it's very important. That's all I want to say.